Welcome to the panel discussion, Plants and Animals and Humans, Oh My. What is One Health and what does it have to do with your future career? I'm Jeff Wichtel and I'm the Dean of the Ontario Veterinary College at the University of Guelph, and I'm privileged to be your host today. First, I wish to offer gratitude to the land on which the University of Guelph is situated and the Indigenous peoples who have resided here for centuries. We recognize the treaty lands of the Mississaugas of the Credit and the Dish with One Spoon Wampum. We offer respect to the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples who call our territory home and acknowledge our responsibilities to the generations yet to come. With all that we're experiencing right now, there has never been a better time to talk about health. The term One Health may be unfamiliar to you, but by the end of this hour, we believe you'll go away with a good working knowledge of the One Health approach and how it can help us solve some of our most complex health problems. COVID-19, have we ever heard of that? Well, it's a disease that arose from a wildlife reservoir. Is that unusual? Well, actually, no. 75% of new diseases for humans actually come from animals. Combine that fact with the many social factors such as poverty and environmental factors such as climate change that impact human and animal health, and you can see that we need a holistic approach to solving these health problems. We need to think more in terms of systems and not silos. We need to be able to work effectively in interdisciplinary teams. This is the One Health approach. Our panelists today, a medical doctor, an anthropologist, a veterinarian, and an engineer, they have each led and worked in interdisciplinary teams such as this. They're going to share their experiences with you and offer advice on how one might pursue a One Health oriented career. Before I introduce our panelists, I need to let you know that today's presentation is being recorded and will be available later. The video, audio, and chat functions have been disabled for attendees, but you can submit questions using the Q&A function down below anytime you like. We'll first let the panelists have the floor, and then we'll answer the questions afterwards. But please feel free to submit your questions at any time, and if possible, let us know which panelists you'd like to direct them to. I'll now introduce our panel. Dr. Deb Stark. Dr. Stark serves on the University of Guelph Board of Governors, as well as on the boards of Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada's Audit and Advisory Committee, Canadian Agricultural Policy Institute, Ontario Genomics, and Ontario Agricultural Hall of Fame Association. She is a former Deputy Minister, the Ontario Ministry of Ag, Food, and Rural Affairs, holding various senior leadership roles within that ministry and also the Ministry of Environment, including serving as Ontario's first Chief Veterinary Officer. Dr. Heather Murphy. Dr. Murphy is an Associate Professor, the Department of Pathobiology at the Ontario Veterinary College. With a background in engineering, her research focuses on water quality and distribution, wastewater treatment, risk assessment, and studies in environmental health. Her research has taken her all over the world, including Cambodia, Madagascar, Mali, and the United States. Dr. Travis Steffens. Dr. Steffens is an assistant professor in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at the University of Guelph. His research focuses on linear human interaction within shared environments. He is the founder and executive director of Planet Madagascar. Planet Madagascar is a conservation, education, and community development not-for-profit that works closely with local communities to improve the lives of people who live in Madagascar and to conserve lemurs and their habitat. And Dr. Samira Mubareka. Dr. Mubareka is a microbiologist at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center in Toronto. Her research focuses on viral disease transmission and spread. Her research also focuses on pathogen emergence in livestock, something we just mentioned recently. Early during the COVID-19 virus pandemic, Dr. Mubareka and her colleagues isolated the SARS-CoV-2 virus, which is now the principal source of the virus for research labs right across Canada. She also serves on a number of Canada's COVID-19 expert panels. Thank you very much to my panelists. And first, Dr. Stark, I wonder if you can kick us off.
Great, thanks, Jeff. And welcome everybody. In another time, if we were in a world room together, I would ask you to raise your hand if you had ever considered being a veterinarian. And I suspect that quite a few hands would go up. And then I'd ask you to think about what, how do you picture yourself when you think about being a veterinarian? And I doubt if many of you would think about being behind a desk and meetings all day on the phone, dealing with politicians. And I can tell you that neither did I. Never in my wildest dreams when I graduated from veterinary school was that my vision. I graduated like most veterinarians at my time, thinking I was going to be in clinical practice. And that's where I started. I did farm animals in the morning, worked with the cats and dogs in the afternoon, and it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. But even then, I sensed that there was something missing, something that I didn't have when I was thinking about how to help my patients. Things they hadn't talked to us about in vet school actually made a difference, like the income level of the owner, or the soil, the quality of the soil the farmer was using to grow his crops. After 5 years, I decided to go back to school and do an MBA. And I took a part-time job at that time with the government just to pay the bills. I thought I would stay for 3 years, and I ended up staying for 30. And I have to say that I loved almost every moment of it. I really liked the first job. That was an extension job. So I was working with veterinarians in the field and animal owners and trying to improve conditions on the farms in general and helping animals that way. Then I had an opportunity, and it was life-changing for me, to take a management position. Now, I have to tell you, at least when I was a new graduate, there was kind of a hierarchy in terms of veterinary jobs. If you were a real veterinarian, you were in practice, at least if you were young, as I was at that time. Research, academics, yeah, okay. Industry, government, well, maybe. But nowhere on that list was management. Not only that, it was a regulatory position. So that's the policeman, that's the enforcer. And that is not what you think of when you think of being a veterinarian. We're there to help, not issue permits. If it had been a permanent decision, I would have maybe said no, but it was a temporary thing. It was a chance to try something different. And so I gave it a try. And as I said, that was life-changing for me. I entered a world where the problems were so much bigger. It took so much longer to see whether or not you were actually making a difference. But when you did have a breakthrough and make a change, the impact was huge. I was able to lead the restructuring of the animal health diagnostic labs across the province of Ontario. During the BSE crisis, I represented Ontario at national and international tables. And I helped create the legislation we have today that allows the province to deal with animal health emergencies. And I learned a lot. I learned that people's opinions differ a lot based on the experience they have. I learned that politicians cannot always wait for the scientists. And I learned that if you have a big, complicated problem, the best thing you can do is to bring a whole whack of different experts to the table to try and sort it out. I finished my career as deputy minister in the Minister of Agriculture, and the deputy minister position is considered the senior policy advisor to the minister and to cabinet in general. And in that position, you get to work with a lot of other ministries in different cross files. And that was the most interesting part of the job, as far as I was concerned. I got to help design a cap and trade program. I got to help design the Greenbelt. And we worked with Ontario and Canada and Quebec and the United States and states on an action plan to clean up the Great Lakes. I was asked to talk specifically about government policy and how One Health lens fits in with government policy development. And I thought it would be easiest just to give you a couple of examples. I have three, actually. The first one's in the world of emergency management, specifically about evacuations. I hope you all know that the government of Ontario hopes that you should plan to be on your own for the first 72 hours during an emergency, that you would have enough food, water, batteries for the cell phone, that kind of thing. And that you should also think about having to evacuate. Now think about that. If there was a fire or a flood and you were being told that you had to leave your home, but you were being told that you could not take your animals, would you go? That was the way things used to be. the first responders, if they came and came to rescue you, would often tell you you had to leave your pets behind. It just wasn't considered an important thing. Human lives were the important lives. Everything else could wait. It was a veterinarian from the United States called Sebastian Heath who shone a light on why this is a problem. When he looked at why people didn't evacuate or why they would go back, he found one of the number one reasons was if they had animals. As I say, people would often refuse to leave, or they would go, but then they would come back early, checking in on their pets, and therefore putting both themselves and the first responders at great risk. And he was one of the first ones to show us all that communities had to consider animals in their evacuation plans if they wanted to have successful ones. Because in Ontario, I was sitting as a manager, not as a veterinarian, but as a manager at the government's emergency planning table, I was able to bring that research to that table, and I was able to shine a light on this and help when we think about evacuations. And, you know, of course, it's never all about one person. It's never all about one piece of research. But I do think it is one of the reasons that now communities understand that if they want to have a successful evacuation strategy, they do need to think about the animals, not just for the animals, but for the people. The second example has to do with bees. So a few years ago, the bee owners, the people that keep the hives, were very concerned because they were having a lot of losses. They were very convinced that it was a pesticide that the farmers were using that was killing their bees, and they wanted that pesticide banned right away. Farmers were not so convinced. They wanted time to show that they could make some changes and make some improvements and see if they could work on the problem together. But the public was very taken with the whole picture of dying bees, and they wanted something done right away. I was in the Ministry of Agriculture at that time, and we worked with the Ministry of the Environment to really dig into that problem and figure out what was the best advice to give to the elected officials. And what we did is we put together a team of experts, and we studied what was going on in bee populations, not just in Ontario, but around the world. We looked at the pesticides and the residues and where they were and if there were any and what was happening. We looked at the hives and how they were being managed. And we brought veterinarians to the table to really to dig into why those particular bees were dying. And we found out that there were several factors, not the least including a significant loss of habitat and some new diseases that bees were having trouble adapting to, and some parasites as well. It turns out that we all have a role in protecting the bees. We have to really think about preserving habitat and grow pollinator gardens and things like that. But the real point of my message is that if we'd just gone with the first answer, ban the pesticide, we would not have solved that problem. It was more complex than that, and it needed a One Health approach. And my final example is happening right as we speak. At this point in time, there are two veterinarians in the most senior levels at the federal government dealing with the world's biggest challenges. Just this spring, Dr. Harpreet Kochhar was appointed the Associate Deputy Minister of Health with the very specific task of bringing all the federal departments together and coordinating our response to COVID-19. And since 2017, Dr. Martine Dubuc has been the Associate Deputy Minister of Environment and Climate Change. And she's charged with making sure that Canada meets its climate change commitments and helping build a greener future for us all. These are very talented individuals with a passion for public policy and a One Health point of view. I doubt if either one of them graduated as a graduate veterinarian those first few days thought that they would be spending their time as a senior government official. But I suspect that, like me, they were curious and kept on asking, what is the real root of this problem? How is it connected to other things? How do things all fit together in this world? And most importantly, what can we as humans do to make it a better place? And that, in my opinion, is a One Health approach. Thank you. And Jeff, I think I'll turn it back to you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Dr. Stark. And I really appreciate your presentation and your perspective on your career. And I'd like to now invite Dr. Murphy.
Thank you, Jeff, and thank you everyone for joining us today. I'm going to give you a bit of my career path to One Health, and I have a few slides to show you to kind of illustrate where I've come to where I am now. Next slide, please, Alex. So my background, I'm the engineer on the panel. I call myself, I guess, a water treatment engineer by training, and I've been doing this for over 16 years, and I've worked all over the world. I did my PhD in environmental engineering from the University of Guelph, and I specialize in water treatment appropriate for developing countries. And then went on to, and I also have a master's degree in applied science and civil engineering, where I first really grew interested in drinking water quality, and I worked on drinking water distribution system quality in particular. Next slide, Alex. So a bit of my path down this road, I started at Dalhousie really interested in drinking water treatment. And the more I learned about drinking water, the more I realized that people like us, we take water for granted. We get fresh water from the tap that is usually of extremely high quality. And we also literally flush it down the toilet. And the more I learned about water challenges in other countries around the world, the more I got interested in doing more than just treating water in North America. And I really wanted to pursue further graduate studies or gain experience overseas. So after my master's degree, I worked for a little while in private industry for a water treatment company for about 4 months. And I really didn't enjoy it at all. I took all the money I made, I bought a plane ticket to Southeast Asia, and I went on a backpacking trip for 4 months and spent all of the money that I had made at that employment and came back to Canada with a different perspective and chose to pursue a PhD that will allow me to do research that looked at water challenges in developing nations. And I had some advisors in engineering that were brave enough to take me on as a student and allowed me to go to Cambodia and figure out a PhD project on my own. And so I went and spent several months with a non-governmental organization, and I started asking lots of questions about these different water treatment devices. So you can see in the middle picture there, that's me taking some water samples from a ceramic water filter. And as I asked more questions, I realized there was a lot of scientific questions that were unanswered about these technologies. And I went about and tried to answer those questions. When I finished my PhD, I had no interest in going into academia, despite that I've made my way back here now. And I went and worked for UNICEF in Mali and Madagascar as a water sanitation and hygiene specialist for several years. And while I was there, I started to learn about the interventions that UNICEF does in terms of providing safe water and latrines and hand washing interventions and what that does on child health. And we were looking at, we were working with many different universities from around the world that were studying the interventions that we were doing as implementers and trying to see if what we were actually doing was having an effect on child health. And I was really intrigued. And that's where I kind of started to move towards public health and more away from engineering, because I really wanted to understand, well, what was the public health implication of what we were doing? Next slide, Alex. So I returned to Canada and I took a research fellowship with the Public Health Agency of Canada. And that's a newspaper clipping from the study that we published when I was a research fellow there. And it says, study reveals hidden dangers of tap water, millions of Canadians drinking from substandard sources. And that was a bit of a sensationalized headline, but in a nutshell, we were trying to quantify what would be the burden of disease associated with drinking water in Canada. So how many people get sick from drinking water and why? And through that experience, I got really interested in water challenges on First Nations communities. And I did a small fellowship at the University of Guelph where we looked at challenges faced by those in First Nations communities. And then did another small fellowship at McMaster University looking at drinking water distribution systems before I ended up with a faculty position in the United States. Next slide, Alex. And so for the last 5 years up until September 1st of this year, I made my way into a College of Public Health at Temple University and looked at waterborne diseases in the context of drinking water, recreational water, in terms of wastewater management in developing countries, and a whole slew of different waterborne research related to waterborne diseases. And then I've made my way to the Ontario Veterinary College, and I was hired to work in the area of One Health. And I have to say, I've been doing interdisciplinary work for many, many years, but I've never focused on animal health. And so now I'm tasked with working at the interface of environmental health, public health, and now animal health. And I'm working with a team of researchers here to develop a proposal that looks at the impact of different agricultural practices on animal health, environmental health, and ultimately public health. Next slide, Alex. And so this is my last slide. And I want to show you that kind of this is where I would say my expertise lies, all of these different bubbles here. But what I want to tell you is that I don't have formal training in all of these areas. I am running what they call a randomized control trial in the United States, and that would be an epidemiological study. But I am not an epidemiologist, and I have not been any formal training. I do risk assessment, and I have a very little formal training on that. Global environmental health, I learned by doing when I was overseas, but I didn't take any actual global environmental health classes, even though I've taught them as a professor. So I want to leave you with, there's no wrong way to go in your career. You can end up wherever you want, and you can take very different paths to get there. And I want to give you confidence that you won't pick something wrong when you pick a degree in if you go off to post-secondary education, that you can kind of always make your way to a new area if you're so brave to do so. So with that, I'm going to pass it back to Jeff. Thank you.
Oh, that's great. Thank you, Heather. Really, you exemplify not just the One Health approach in science, but also the courage that one needs to set aside, you know, traditional training silos and just go for it when you have a problem to solve and bring the team together that you need. So wonderful. I'd now like to invite Dr. Steffens to speak.
Hello, wonderful, thank you very much. So how I became a One Health researcher is in some ways very similar to the others on the panel. Is I didn't start off this way. I didn't think I was gonna become a One Health researcher when I started entering my career. And I'm an early career researcher just starting out this year, in fact, at the University of Guelph. So I'm just gonna tell you a little bit of story of how I got here. You can switch slides, please. So my journey began on the way to One Health when I was sitting in a tree as an eight-year-old with my best friend, Kevin. We looked at each other and said, what do you want to be when you grow up? I had a fantastic response because I knew exactly what I wanted to do when I was that age. I wanted to become a monkey. Now I realized, because my friend Kevin punched me in the shoulder and said, you can't be a monkey. And I realized that wasn't possible. So I said, fine, I want to study monkeys then. Next slide, please. But there was a major problem. I lived in Calgary. That's the photo on the left. It was cold. There were no primates. I needed to go to the places that looked like the photo on the right. It's tropical forests, places where monkeys lived. But fortunately, I was quite lucky in that the University of Calgary actually had a program in primatology under the umbrella of anthropology. So I, after taking the first year course in biological anthropology, I was hooked. Next slide, please. And why not? Look at these things. Primates are incredible. Next slide. However, university didn't really come easy for me. And if you take a peek at this transcript, this is actually my transcript from my second year where I dipped down to a 1.77 GPA and was put on academic probation, which they did back then. And they sent you a letter. And they said, if you don't get above a certain GPA by a certain date, you'll be permanently expelled from university. So I did what any respectful student would do at that point. I dropped out. But I still have this passion. I really wanted to go and study primates. So after taking a year off and sorting myself out, I went back to school and I decided I was going to do this. I was going to figure out what it took to become a primate researcher. Well, because my early academics weren't great, my later academics were just fine. But because of those early first 2 years, I was had a bit of an albatross on my back, trying to get above this grade issue that I had. But I did know one thing. I was very good at working in the field. I was very outdoorsy, spent a lot of time in the mountains in Calgary. So I had an opportunity to do a field school in Belize where I was able to show those skills. That field school led to an opportunity in grad school after being rejected in the first application, to eventually go and survey the entire country of Belize looking for howler monkeys, trying to find out where they were and how they lived. Next slide. But my real interests were in where primates were and why they were there when faced with human disturbance. And there's no better place in the world to understand this than Madagascar. Madagascar has situations like you see in this image where massive amounts of deforestation have occurred. In this case, where I work, because of humans burning grasses so they can graze their cattle. And so somewhere lemurs have to live. And in fact, in that tiny little fragment, you could kick a soccer ball over, there's still lemurs there. Next slide, please. Well, this burning and grazing of cattle creates erosion scars. These erosion scars drain into the rivers. Next slide, please. And this is an image from the space station taken by the astronauts up there. And they say the same thing that they say every time they fly past Madagascar, when they see this very river, they say, it looks like Madagascar is bleeding again. And that erosion scar I showed you is what drains into this river. Next slide, please. Yet even in that tiny fragment, there are tons of different types of lemurs. And so this island has over 100 species. And I was desperate to get there and desperate to understand how they were surviving in this situation. Next slide, please. I won't bore you with the science of this, but my research focused on three biogeographic models. I wanted to understand how many species existed in these tiny fragments. I wanted to understand how many individuals of each species were there. And I wanted to understand that at a landscape level, where we're looking at multiple fragments at the same time. The short version of the answer of what I found was that lemurs are resilient. Considering how much forest has been lost, they're still there. Although it's looking dire, the amount of forest and the isolation of that forest is impacting them dramatically. In fact, they're the most endangered animal group that we measure. 95% are threatened with extinction. But what I realized when I was doing all this work, that there are problems that lemurs facing were obviously inextricably linked with the people that lived in connection to them, because it was people who were burning these forests and grazing their cattle to maintain their livelihoods. Next slide, please. And because of this, I decided during my PhD that studying lemurs wasn't enough. I needed to do something about the sort of humanitarian crisis I was seeing in these poor communities I was working with, and the conservation crisis I was seeing facing lemurs. And the reality that these two were inextricably linked. Lemurs and people lived in the same forests. I created three types of projects. They're called community conservation and communication projects. The community projects work directly with communities to solve problems regarding health, food, and income security. The conservation projects work to protect and restore forests that both people and lemurs live. And the communications project looks to deliver education to people, conservation education projects to people who live in connection to lemurs. Next slide, please. So now I'm taking my biogeography research that I did previously and looking to understand how diseases from humans and domestic animals that live in connection to lemurs will actually move in that way. So they'll go from, instead of, we often talk about zoonotic diseases, diseases that move from animals to people. But here there's the opposite scenario where we have this highly endangered group of animals that are susceptible to some of the same diseases that humans and domestic animals carry. And those diseases may push these species near to extinction. And so I'll be looking at the relationship of things like Cryptosporidium and Giardia amongst people, lemurs, and domestic animals. Next slide, please. So that brings me to my position here at the University of Guelph. I didn't actually think of myself as a One Health researcher, even though I was working on many of these topics for a number of years. It wasn't until the position here at the university came up and my supervisor emailed me and says, this is what you do. You should apply for this. And when I started thinking about what One Health was, how it was about the interface of humans, animals, and the environment, I realized that, yeah, through my primate biogeography, I interfaced with animals and their environment. Through the forest restoration and management, I was looking at the environment. I spend a lot of time with the communities understanding how they perceive forests, conservation, and lemurs. So I was understanding the interface between humans and the environment and humans and animals. But we also address human health in the nonprofit that I work with. And because the humans rely very heavily on livestock, we'll be addressing things that regarding veterinary medicine. So as a whole, no one project actually works towards One Health necessarily, but when you look at all of them together, it suddenly becomes a One Health program. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Travis. That's an inspiring story about how you overcame obstacles, some of them self-made perhaps, to really reach your dream of working with the animals and the people that you want to work with. So thank you for that. We're receiving some questions. I appreciate those, and they will be answered towards the end. So keep submitting the questions. Thanks very much for your interest. Now, Dr. Mubareka, would you like to give us your presentation?
Certainly. So my name is Samira Mubareka, or for most people, that would be Sam. Je viens de Saint-Joseph de Madawaska, Nouveau-Brunswick. Alors bonjour à tous les Franco-Ontariens, Franco-Ontariennes. I'm amazed at, despite having very diverse career paths, how there's some similarities. Travis, when someone asked me about what I wanted to be when I grew up, I responded that I wanted to be a cat. So I think certainly having sort of these aspirations is probably one of the similarities between all of us. What I'd like to tell today is the story, not just of my own career path, but also the story of viral zoonoses and how we've learned a number of lessons, not just personal life lessons, but just lessons in general. Certainly in the modern era, there's been no shortage of these potential pathogens. And they've also taught us that we really need to look at a far more macroscopic level than we've traditionally been taught when we think about zoonoses and pathogens. So I'm going to start way back to when I started off in medicine, and I also started at Dalhousie University. And at that time, the HIV/AIDS epidemic was starting, and it had really established itself at a global level. The demographics or the populations, the people who were getting infected, the risk factors that they had were changing over time. But it became very, very evident that this was a virus that was going to pose some very considerable challenges, especially to the patients, but also to the medical field. It was also one of the first times that it really dawned on me that infection is very closely linked to inequality. And if that's something that you're interested in, reading Paul Farmer's Infection and Inequality about the HIV/AIDS outbreak in Haiti is a great place to start. So it was really the first time in modern medicine that we were faced with a viral infection that, you know, the provenance was unclear where it had come from. How it spread became evident, but what to do about it, people felt really powerless. And the other challenge was it wasn't just about the virus. The virus did such damage to the immune system that there were all these other infections, some of which we had treatments for, but many of which we didn't, or they were really challenging toxic treatments that we had to use. And very sadly, early in those days, a lot of people died. The other story that I want to tell in parallel is also the story of people. There are individuals along this journey that it's so funny how one person can make all the difference. And it was really Claire Touche. I don't know where she is now, but if there's any chance that she's listening, thank you very much, because you know, she was an infectious diseases physician, and it hadn't really occurred to me to do infectious diseases until I met her and saw the care that she provided to HIV patients who were admitted or in clinic. So fortunately, there's been considerable progress as far as HIV is concerned. There are still a lot of challenges that remain, but nonetheless, we've certainly made considerable advances. Now, several years later, if we just accelerate a little bit, at that point, I had been hooked on infectious diseases, not only because of the challenges that I've just described, but also the fact that infectious diseases docs are kind of a fun bunch. it's strange to say this, but it's the lowest paid specialty in medicine. So that attracts a certain type, and also that's attached to a certain humor that I have to say has been surpassed by vets. I think vets actually have a better sense of humor than infectious diseases dogs, but it really has a lot to do with who you have met along the way. So I went to McGill and did infectious diseases rotations there during internal medicine, and just really clicked with the group and decided to make it my career. So I went on to Winnipeg and did both infectious diseases and medical microbiology. The reason I was so interested in medical microbiology was because of the potential research aspect related to the lab work that you can do in microbiology. And it was kind of a nice tie to the patient. And that's really when I started to think about zoonoses a little bit more. So again, it was really a coincidence, meeting the right people at the right time. And I tagged along one day. It was just one day that made all the difference, whereby I tagged along with a group of virologists who were going out into the field to collect deer mice to look for hantavirus. And it was such a surreal experience because there we were in, you know, one of the farmers' barns wearing full PPE with PAPRs and everything while the farmers were wandering around in their regular day clothes. I'm sure that we were a great source of amusement for them. But just getting out of the lab and getting out of the hospital and seeing a broader world is what really opened my eyes to not just the virus, but the viral ecology. That's something that I hadn't really thought about before because it's not traditionally taught that way. But viral ecology probably has more bearing, it certainly has much bearing on the downstream effects and the impact of viral activity than some of the molecular determinants of the viruses themselves. And sometimes those two things are tied together. So there I was in Winnipeg looking at viruses and respiratory virus, and then SARS happened. So that was back in 2002, 2003. And if you recall, SARS coronavirus 1 did initially start on the other side of the world. So the initial cases were in Hong Kong and other parts of Asia. And it was really the first time that we realized that coronaviruses could be high consequence viruses. We hadn't really thought about them that way. We thought of them as common cold viruses, at least in the human health field. Obviously, in animal health, there's a huge breadth and diversity of coronaviruses that cause a much more significant spectrum of disease. But as far as we were concerned, they really were fairly innocuous, at least as far as the common cold was concerned. The other thing that SARS coronavirus 1 did was really highlight the potential for global spread for some of these viruses. That really hadn't been as underscored before. So in no time flat, there were cases in Canada, including at the hospital that I work at now. And that led to another revelation that these viruses could infect people, obviously, but also healthcare workers. So really for the first time, you know, we always worry about hospital acquired infections, lab acquired infections, what we call nosocomial exposure. So those are exposures in hospital settings, things like tuberculosis and viral hepatitis. But this was really the first time healthcare workers actually worried about dying from exposures on the job. So that had a huge impact on the field. It also underscored the interface between humans and animals. I mean, it's very well recognized for other viruses like influenza virus, but we haven't really thought about it in the same way, particularly as far as bats were concerned. And we know now that bats are a potential reservoir for a number of different viruses. We have a greater appreciation for trying to understand viral ecology now, not only for human health, but for animal health as well. So then if we fast forward to 2009, yet another virus emerges. It's this time an influenza virus, but not where we were looking. We were doing so much surveillance in areas like Asia where highly pathogenic avian influenza virus was circulating. So that was the H5 virus. This one came from a different group of hosts, so from swine. And it also came from a completely different jurisdiction from Central America. So it spread very, very quickly and was also another example of where you can get what we call reverse zoonoses, or anthropozoonoses, where the virus spreads back into animals. And then I'll summarize with the current situation where we've kind of come full circle yet again. So with SARS coronavirus 2, we've seen the virus spill over from an animal reservoir. We don't know if it's through an intermediate into humans. And now, as many of you recently heard, back into animals and possibly back into humans again. So if you haven't seen it on the news, there have been cases in mink, initially in the Netherlands, the US, most recently in Denmark. And we know now that it can spill over to other mink, other species of animals, and back into humans. So really understanding not just the virus itself, but viral ecology and human behavior has been really an eye-opening experience for me. And it's really brought me to this One Health place like the other individuals in this panel. I really didn't set out to be a One Health person, but I'm so thrilled that I am now. And it's really thanks to a lot of the great biologists and veterinarians and animal health folks that I've met along the way. So I'll stop there, and I think it's time for questions.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Mubareka. I think you really, I'm glad you mentioned the human side of the science that you do and how important human behavior is to actually translating the One Health findings into to action that can save lives. So appreciate that. Yes, we have had several questions submitted. Some have been answered. So I encourage you to look at the Q&A and you'll see that some of those questions have already been answered. I think, yeah, we'll take Anna's question first. Is it true that water we drink today worldwide contains small plastic particles? How can that affect everyone in the future, humans, animals, and the environment? And Dr. Murphy has agreed to answer this question.
Yeah, thank you, Anna, for your question. It's a really good one. It is true that our water contains small particles of plastic, and we are finding that that is true all around the world. What really isn't known is what the potential health implications are on human and animal health. That's still being explored, but hypothetically, plastics do contain chemicals that have been known to be linked to cancers and other health conditions, and therefore, hypothetically, if we get enough of those plastics in our bodies and they accumulate in some way, they could cause health concerns. But that research is still really, really quite new. I hope that answers your question.
That's great. Dr. Murphy, I know that you wrote quite a long answer to Margaret's questions around water quality in Indigenous communities, First Nations communities. But I just wondered if you think it's important enough a question that perhaps that it's worthy for you to respond verbally as well.
Yeah, I'd be happy to respond verbally. I actually ran out of space while I was typing, so it stopped letting me write any additional information. So I think water challenges in First Nations communities, like any community around the world, is really challenging. And I think people forget that solving these problems are very context specific. And oftentimes people want an approach that can be scaled up and dealt with rapidly. And that doesn't always work. And you really need to spend time with communities. And I'm sure Travis can probably speak to that in his work in Madagascar, that really learning what the problems are of the community and matching the solution to those problems and making sure there is a plan that is sustainable will go a long way. And I do think the federal government is moving in that direction. But I think historically, I can speak from water treatment interventions globally around the world. We have wells that are broken in countries everywhere, and people go and drill a well and then say, yes, I've done my job, I've drilled the well, but they didn't bother to teach anybody how to fix it when it breaks. So it breaks 10 months later, and then that community now no longer has water supply. So I can say, like, that's an oversimplified version, but that's the kind of challenges that we're facing in First Nations communities and we face all around the world.
Wonderful, thank you. I think a question that's on everybody's mind, are we bound to see more and more outbreaks like COVID-19? Maybe Dr. Mubareka would be interested in replying to that.
Unfortunately, I think the answer is yes. I really regret to say that. There are a number of reasons that that may be. We know that viral richness is associated with host diversity. So animals that are very rich in diversity, so rodents, for example, bats are another example, tend to harbor a lot of zoonotic viruses. And as we encroach on their habitat, we bring together humans and animals. And within each of those animals, let's just take bats, for example, there's such a diversity of viruses, and viruses are always changing. So all it needs is an opportunity to adapt to another host that then will lead to a selection for that what we'll call permissive or beneficial adaptation that then lets it continue to spill over into other hosts. That all starts with us coming into that space. And I think that we're, based on what we're observing now in terms of human behavior, that's only likely to increase. The other thing that relates to it is abundance of animals. So animals that are highly abundant, so in this case, agricultural animals, also can be related to zoonotic viruses. So making sure that we keep on top of biosecurity and those kind of things, I think many of you who do farm understand that quite well, becomes a very, very important issue to protect not only the health of humans, but especially the health of the animals as well.
Jeff, can I come in on that one?
Sure, please do.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that it's not just viruses. And when you think of there's other things. Mad cow disease was caused by something called a prion, which is not a bacteria or a virus, yet a different thing. Lyme disease, we're seeing more of that. That's transferred by ticks, so parasite infections. It's the whole ecosystem and the whole community, and the more we live in each other's back pockets or the more we disrupt those systems, the more likely we're to see impacts because of that.
Thank you. We have a question here from one panelist to another. So this one's for you, Travis. You talked about your ups and downs on your path towards your current position, and yet you persevered. And I'm wondering, you know, what you would tell people in high school or early in their higher education journey, you know, how they should handle such failure, and what's the secret to triumph?
Yeah, the partly is just persevering through failure, recognizing that failure is a tool that you can use to improve yourself. My partner, she's an overachiever, so she didn't fail very often, and when failure approached her, as it does everybody, it came later in life, and it was harder to deal with. I had the fortunate situation of failing often and early, which gave me sets of skills that I could use to move forward. But also realizing that if you really want to do the thing, how that thing looks like may not be exactly the same as what you envisioned it. But there are pathways, regardless of what has happened in your life. I won't get into my story in detail, but you can see it. There's a TEDx talk. You can just Google my name in TEDx and you'll find it. But it talks about these adversities that everyone faces. And if you can find your route through there, just keeping, I think I said in the talk, you set goals, persevere through failure. And I can't remember the last one, but it's basically pointing in a direction and just keep following the path that brings you there, even though it may not be a straight line.
Great, thanks very much. We have a question here from Anna. As an undergraduate student currently finishing up last semester, I'm encouraged by the fact that each of the panelists today have had such a unique and not necessarily clear-cut career path. All of you mentioned not entering your fields with the intention of being One Health researchers, and yet here you are. How would you encourage young people who may not specifically be trained in One Health to pursue such a career? So, Anyone of you could answer that question. Maybe we'll begin with Dr. Stark.
Yeah, I could start off, and I think Travis kind of had the I think Travis had the thing there, which is kind of set the goal, and but don't be afraid to try different ways to reach it. There isn't just one path. And it is really a matter of thinking about what you've gained in your experience, in your training, and how you can use it, and how you can, here's an overworked word, but how you can pivot to move you closer to your goal. So I think the diversity of the panelists here talk about how we all came at it from a different path. There is no one path to a One Health career. There is no one definition of what a One Health career really is, especially at this point in time. It's a way of looking at the world. It is a way of approaching problems, but it's not boxed in. And so you get a chance to help create that. So I would say if that's something you want to do, just hold that vision in front of you. Keep working to it, but don't be afraid to zig and zag on the way, because the other thing you will probably find, one of the things I found during my career is every time I went where I thought I was going off track, I had some of the richest experiences and I learned so much because I was in a slightly different place and a little bit outside of my comfort zone. And that's where I really learned and that's where I grew. So don't be afraid of that.
Thank you. Do any of the other panelists have anything to add?
I could add something. I would say, yeah, look for different opportunities and like don't see what comes your way, but also set a goal in a maybe a path that you want to go. But if it's not going to work out, see another way that you can get to that path, kind of just what Deb said. So I'm going to give you an example to illustrate that, because I didn't talk about one of my failures. I really wanted to work in development when I finished my master's, and I was determined I could get an internship. I wasn't going to get paid. It was an unpaid internship. I applied for a ton of them. I didn't get a single one. Oh, I was just crushed. And that's when I just kind of pivoted. And I was like, well, I'm going to create my own experience. I've got a backpack, a plane ticket, and here I go. So it doesn't always work out. Like Travis said, dealing with failure a little bit early on might help you as you get older. And don't be afraid to just try new things. And I do think go with something you're passionate about, because you don't want to do a job that you hate. Like, look at something you're really interested in and start there and then move forward. And then more things will be interesting to you and then you'll automatically pivot.
That's great. I can just imagine what your parents said when you took off to Asia intending to spend what little money you'd saved.
Yeah, they were not thrilled, I'm not gonna lie.
But look what it led to. So that's great. I wonder, I might step in here while, you know, if you're an undergrad student or a high school student, you might look around for academic programs to prepare you for One Health, and there aren't many, it's true. But because One Health as a language and is gaining traction throughout society and even popping up in government policy documents and even legislation as a desired approach to deal with complex health issues and things like antimicrobial resistance and these other issues that are important to us. Slowly but surely, we're starting to see academic programming at universities that are specifically targeted to One Health careers. And we'll share a link at the end of this presentation that will guide you to a University of Guelph website that can help you with some of those that are either in place now or are expected to be in place soon. We've just got only a few minutes left. I wonder if each of our panelists could just speak to one, either a skill, a competency, an attribute that prospective One Health folks could kind of cultivate in themselves or during their training, or were in fact important to you to cultivate for your career. So perhaps let's start with Travis.
Yeah, so for me, like I said before, I didn't even know what One Health was until I saw the application. And in fact, I had a friend who kept telling me, you're doing One Health. And I completely disagreed with him because I was like, no, I'm a primate biogeographer. It's a totally different thing. And so the switch for me was understanding that how primates interact with their landscape is not in isolation. And most things that we deal with is not isolated phenomena, but we've siloed our universities into this into these separate disciplines so we can try to understand very specific portions of phenomena, not fully appreciating that they're all actually completely interconnected. And for me, that's one beautiful thing about One Health is it allows us to break down some of those barriers, which provide benefit. Having silos can be good in some ways because you have expertise, but breaking down those barriers are necessary to solve complex problems. And so that's, that there was an aha moment for me earlier and not that long ago, really.
That's great. Dr. Mubareka, what's one attribute or competency that you think folks should really try and cultivate?
I think being open to taking risks. I think as Heather just mentioned now, I think that was a great example when she talked about how she actually dealt with failure. It was a risk for her to do that, but obviously it worked out exceptionally well. I think being open to that and not being, again, you know, Travis just said the word siloed. You know, for example, in medicine is just full of tracks. We talk about tracks, we're on this track, we're on that track. And I know some of my colleagues look at me and say, what are you doing? You know, the track people, but I'm very happy with what I'm doing and being, meeting, I know I mentioned this before, but meeting people that you really like and click and connect with and then work with them, even if they're not exactly in your field, that's probably where the most interesting work will happen is at that interface. So figure out an excuse to work with them. And then you'll also have a really personally rewarding experience through that relationship. And you'll learn a lot as well.
Great. So courage is the answer. Dr. Stark, maybe you have something to add.
Yeah, this is a tough one to add onto this one, but I guess I would say curiosity. Keep on being curious. How does this fit together? How do these things impact each other? And just in terms of career tips, when I was always trying to decide whether or not to take a different position, I asked myself two questions. First of all, could I help? And secondly, would I learn? I didn't want to be in a position where I felt like I really had nothing to offer. But I always wanted to be in a position where I felt like I was going to be learning something. And that has served me very well. And so I offer that as a bit of advice as well.
Words to live by. Dr. Murphy, apparently your attribute is risk-taking, but anyway, maybe you have something else to offer.
Yeah, I agree so much with what all the other panelists have said. And in terms of career advice, I would say work on your networking skills. Now, you might seem too young to be like, networking, what is that? I can't network. But networking is just keeping relationships with people that have been influential in your path all the way through. And those can open doors. And so you don't need to network with everybody you meet, but if you find a few good connections along the way and stay connected, those will turn into a few others. And I've have all sorts of informal mentors that I've kept all throughout my career. And like, I'll give you one specific example. I met a man in Cambodia when I was doing my PhD in this rural village where I worked, and he worked at the World Bank, and he took me into his office, and I was dirty and he was in a suit, and he gave me some great career advice, and we stayed in touch over the years. I've emailed him every few months, and now he is the program officer on my Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation grant. And it's just amazing how the world works and turns around. And so, like, you might think that that interaction as an undergrad student doesn't mean anything, but you might be 15 years later, like me, and that was a really meaningful moment. So keep those connections.
Yeah, wonderful advice. Well, thank you. Heartfelt thank you to our panelists for giving up their evening. It's been really both informative and entertaining. I think you'll agree. I also want to thank the Royal Winter Fair team that's helped us put this panel on, and Alex Vincent and Lisa Cox from the University of Guelph, worked very hard ahead of this to make it all happen faultlessly. For more information on One Health, there are two places you can go. One is to the One Health Pavilion at the Royal Winter Fair site under the University of Guelph, a place to grow site, and you'll find more information on One Health, and also to the website in front of you at the University of Guelph. We encourage you, we're real people at this place, so you can send us an email and it will be answered. We'll be pleased, more than pleased, to answer your questions, the ones that might come to mind after this session. So thank you very much, attendees. Really appreciate your excellent and intelligent questions. And I want to wish you all a good evening.